After studying this module, you shall be able to know about the definition and mechanism of asphyxial deaths, learn the type of asphyxial deaths, learn signs of asphyxia, and learn about the postmortem findings in asphyxial deaths. Coming on to the introduction of asphyxial deaths. Socrates has said much earlier, true wisdom comes to each of us when we realize how little we understand about life, ourselves, and the world around us. Way back, Socrates has said this. Now, asphyxia is a condition caused by interference with the respiration or due to lack of oxygen in the respired air, due to which the organs and tissues are deprived of oxygen, together with the failure to eliminate carbon dioxide, causing unconsciousness or ultimately death. Edelson, a very famous forensic pathologist, has defined asphyxia as, quote, the physiological and chemical state in living organisms in which acute lack of oxygen available for cell metabolism is associated with inability to eliminate excess of carbon dioxide, unquote. Some authors also defined asphyxia as a state or condition of the body in which the supply of oxygen to the blood and tissues has been reduced appreciably below the minimum critical level for maintenance of vital functions of the body by any mechanical interference with the respiration. The term anoxia, which is quite frequently used as asphyxia, this means lack of oxygen. Total lack of oxygen is anoxia. Gordon has classified anoxia into four major categories, that is anoxic anoxia, anemic anoxia, stagnant anoxia, and histotoxic anoxia. So I'll take one by one. Anoxic anoxia, in this condition, the oxygen from the atmosphere cannot get into the blood, like as happens in hanging, strangulation, or breathing in contaminated atmosphere. The anemic anoxia, here the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood is reduced, for example in carbon monoxide poisoning or in acute massive hemorrhages, there occurs the anemic anoxia. Third condition is the stagnant anoxia, where the circulation of blood is impaired so that there is oxygenated blood transport to the tissues is reduced, as happens in heart failure or shock. Fourth is the histotoxic anoxia. Oxygen, although freely available in the bloodstream, cannot be utilized by the tissues due to defect in the enzymatic process, for example, acute cyanide poisoning. The normal levels of oxygen in the arterial blood, what we called as partial pressure of oxygen, with a 95% saturation of hemoglobin, ranges from 90 to 100 millimeters of Hg, that is mercury, in a healthy young adult. The same is 65 to 80 millimeters of mercury in above 60 years of age. The hypoxia occurs when the partial pressure of oxygen, that is PO2, is less than 60 millimeters of mercury, even though the hemoglobin is 90% saturated. And the severe hypoxia occurs when the PO2 falls below 40 millimeters of mercury. And ultimately, death occurs when the PO2 is less than 20 millimeters of mercury. There is a vicious cycle of asphyxia which has been depicted in this diagram, as you can see. The classification of asphyxia, we can classify asphyxia as per the standard classification as mechanical asphyxia, the pathological asphyxia, the toxic asphyxia, the environmental, the traumatic, the postural, as well as iatrogenic. So I will take one by one. The most important medico-legally what we see is the mechanical asphyxia, where the air passages are blocked by mechanical means. To illustrate, the examples are hanging, strangulation, suffocation, and in the suffocation there are various types like entrapment, smothering, gagging, choking, burping, overlaying, traumatic asphyxia, environmental asphyxia, postural or positional asphyxia, and there is a altogether different mechanism, that is drowning. So that was about the mechanical. Now second is the pathological. Here the entry of oxygen in lungs is decreased due to the diseases of the upper respiratory tract or maybe lung. For example, as happens in the bronchitis, in the acute edema of glottis or laryngeal spasm. In the toxic category, the poisonous substances preventing use of oxygen, this happens in the toxic one. For example, as happens in carbon monoxide poisoning or the paralysis of respiratory center in the opium poisoning, barbiturate poisoning, strychnine poisoning, all these. The environmental asphyxia. Here, the insufficient oxygen in the inspired air, for example, in closed spaces, irrespirable gas in the environment, as in sewer gas, high altitude. So this produces the environmental asphyxia. Then the traumatic one. The conditions like bilateral pneumothorax, pulmonary fat embolism from fracture of long bones, or pulmonary thromboembolism due to injury of lower limb. This produces traumatic asphyxia. In postural asphyxia, this happens in unconscious or stuprose person, where upper half of the body is lower than the remainder portion of the body. The iatrogenic one, what happens in the death due to anesthesia or anesthetic deaths. Coming on to the symptoms of asphyxia, there are basically three stages. One is the stage of dyspnea. It is due to the stimulation of the respiratory center due to excess of carbon dioxide. And in clinical picture, there will be slight cyanosis will be there. The second is the stage of convulsions, which occurs due to cerebral irritation. And the patient gives expiratory effort to breathe. And the clinical picture will be cyanosis, hypertension, loss of consciousness, and the pupils are constricted. The third stage is the stage of exhaustion. When finally the person undergoes a stage of exhaustion, there occurs loss of consciousness, the muscles becomes flaccid, the reflexes are lost, the cyanosis becomes deep, the pupils become dilated, and the breathing becomes irregular, what has been specifically called as Cheyne Strokes respiration or Cheyne Strokes breathing, and death occurs in about 3 to 5 minutes. The triad of symptoms of asphyxia, we can say, are basically the congestion, the cyanosis, and the petechial hemorrhage. These three are the asphyxial triad, or these three symptoms are found in all asphyxial deaths. We'll take one by one. Petechial hemorrhage is mainly due to the raised venous pressure, and this leads to impaired venous return. As a result of which, there is over-distension and rupture of venules, which leads to further rupture of venules. It is not due to hypoxia of vessels. The 15 to 30 seconds duration of raised venous pressure is sufficient to produce petechy. The size of petechy varies from 0.1 to 2 millimeters, and the larger size is termed as ecchymosis instead of petechial, and it may be seen anywhere including the viscera, but readily common in the serous membrane, particularly in visceral pleura, interlobar fissures, around the hilum and the pericardium. Petechiae may also be present in the thymus in case of children and infants. In the brain, they are seen in the white matter and also in the subarachnoid space, where superficial vessels have ruptured due to venous engorgement. Multiple petechiae may also be present as a common autopsy artifact during reflection of the scalp flaps in all types of deaths, and basically they are to be ignored, they are of not much significance. In case where the mode of death is congestive heart failure, they are also present in the normal postmortem hypostasis. In cases where the deceased is found in a head lower down position, marked congestion, cyanosis and petechial hemorrhages are one of the vital and common findings. Petechiae can also develop after death over the dependent parts of the body. However, they can be seen rarely on the parietal pleura and peritoneum in hemorrhagic diathesis cases. The second important phenomena is the cyanosis. It is due to reduced oxygen supply to the tissue. Cyanosis is basically a Greek word which means dark blue. In order to appreciate cyanosis, the hemoglobin percentage should be more than 5 g/cl. So that's why it is not apparent in anemia. Basically, cyanosis is the bluish discoloration of the skin, mucous membrane on internal organs. It follows the congestion of the face, as venous blood containing much reduced hemoglobin after perfusing the head and neck becomes more blue. In case where constriction of the neck occurs, cyanosis follows the congestion of the face. If cyanosis was produced during life, then it may be overshadowed partly or wholly by hypostasis, which is deep purple in color and may be mistaken for true cyanosis. If the airway is blocked, then the impaired oxygenation in the lungs causes decrease in the oxygen content of the arterial blood, and which causes darkening of all the organs and tissues, and ultimately will increase the cyanosis of the face. But after about 24 hours of death, oxygen will be dissociated from the blood and cyanosis will appear in any dead body. The cyanosis is marked in places where postmortem lividity develops. The usual more pronounced sites are lips, ears, tip of nose, fingernails, cheeks, and internal organs like lungs, liver, spleen, kidneys, and meninges in the brain. However, more than 5 g/cl of the whole blood should be in the form of reduced hemoglobin to produce cyanosis, irrespective of the total hemoglobin concentration. Hence, the essential cause of cyanosis is diminished oxygen tension in the blood with a rise in proportion of the reduced hemoglobin. When the carotid arteries are obstructed, the intensity of the cerebral, facial and orbital petechiae are less prominent than in cases of venous obstruction. In sudden complete carotid artery occlusion, facial pallor can be one of the striking features. There can be associated bleeding from the ear and nose due to the rupture of small superficial vessels as a result of severe back pressure. And third important phenomena is the congestion and edema. The congestion occurs due to obstructed venous return and capillovenous congestion. The face, the lips, the tongue, they become swollen and reddened due to congestion over the neck. Increased capillary permeability results from a combination of stasis and hypoxia. And this increased capillary and venous permeability causes transudation of fluid into the tissues. Initially, in the early stages, the same is also accompanied by lymph drainage, and hence edema does not occur. When the hypoxia continues, the edema develops. Edema of the lungs is common and is usually due to combination of hypoxia and raised pulmonary vessel pressure. This phenomena indicates the struggle for survival for a time. As a result of back pressure and hypoxia, the brain gets edematous. Both the congestion and edema are non-specific signs and is due to obstructed venous return. Now, coming on to the other non-specific signs of asphyxia other than those triad, what I already explained. Pulmonary edema, the victim attempts to inspire against closed airway, generates a negative pressure, which leads to increased capillary permeability as the alveoli and capillary are damaged. The second non-specific finding is the fluidity of the blood. Increased permeability and degeneration of cell membrane leads to release of plasminogen activator, and which increases the fibrinolytic activity, and this prevents the clotting of blood. These are considered absolute nowadays, as these can be seen in any type of congestive deaths due to generalized rise in the venous and intracardiac pressure. Third is the dilatation of right chambers of heart. This dilatation of the heart chambers on the right side in asphyxial deaths is considered again nowadays absolute, because it is not recorded as pathognomonic sign or characteristic sign. This can be also seen in any type of congestive deaths, including primary heart failure from many other causes, and is mainly due to generalized rise in the venous pressure and intracardiac pressure. Distension of the atria and ventricles are the common postmortem findings due to secondary muscular activity. Now, this diagram depicts what happens in a case of asphyxia, like sphincter relaxation, voiding of urine, the capillary endothelial damage, and the decreased oxygen tension and reduced hemoglobin will in turn lead to cyanosis. Asphyxia may directly lead to unconscious, loss of muscle power. This diagram depicts the summing up of all sequence of events. The postmortem findings in asphyxial deaths can be divided into external and internal. External findings: the non-specific signs are seen, which are common in any kind of violent asphyxial deaths. These are congestion, edema, petechy 0.1 to 2 millimeters of size, ecchymosis if the size is more than 2 millimeters, the cyanosis, the deep postmortem staining, the protrusion of tongue, the bloody and frothy fluid from the mouth and nose, the swelling of face, the prominence of eyeballs, spontaneous defecation, urine, and sperm excretion or seminal emission invariably. The face is either pale in slow asphyxia or distorted, congested, often cyanosed. The eyes are congested with the dilated pupils. The petechial hemorrhages, also known as tardive spots, and they are most marked in the areas where capillary congestion is most prominent for the mechanical regions. Their distribution lies above the level of obstruction and commonly appears as a rash-like shower in the scalp, eyelids, and face in hanging and strangulation, and in the zone above the level of compression in cases of traumatic asphyxia. In case of confusion, a hand lens may be used to identify the petechial hemorrhages. These are produced by simple mechanical obstruction to the venous return of blood from other parts, and thereby causing acute rise in the venous pressure and overdistension and rupture of thin-walled peripheral venules, especially in the lax and unsupported tissues like forehead, skin behind the ears, the eyelids, the conjunctiva, the circumoral skin, the sclera, the buccal mucosa, the neck, the epiglottis, the pericardium, the visceral pleura, thymus, and very rarely in the serosa of the bowel also. Coming on to the internal findings. When we dissect the body, the following findings may be seen depending upon the type of violent asphyxia. Like tardive spots, dark and fluidity of blood, congestion of organs, middle ear bleed, emphysematous lungs, pulmonary edema with froth in trachea and bronchi, bulky, crepitant and over-distended lungs, and the right ventricular dilatation, etc. If heart stops before respiration, the asphyxial signs will be less. The blood is dark in color and fluid because of the increased amount of the carbon dioxide. There may be bursting of small vessels in the eardrums and nose due to increase in the back pressure, which leads to the bleeding. The larynx and trachea are usually congested and may contain varying amount of blood-tinged mucus. The lungs are dark and purple in color. If the back pressure still exists, then there is exudation of serosanguineous fluid in the alveoli, thereby producing edema. However, accumulation of fluid in the dependent or posterior part of the lungs after death should not be confused with the pulmonary edema, because the lungs may also show emphysematous changes near its margin. The abdominal viscera show marked congestion. The brain is congested and cranial sinuses are filled with dark blood. The tardive spots are usually numerous in areas where capillaries are least firmly supported. Example, in subconjunctival tissues under the pleural and pericardial membranes. However, they can be present anywhere depending upon the degree of congestion and cyanosis. They are usually seen as round, dark and well-defined, varying size from pinhead to 2 mm, which may occur as an isolated minute hemorrhage or present in large numbers. At times, they fuse together to form patches of red color, especially at the back of heart. They are numerous in number in the region of auriculoventricular junction of the heart and lower lobes and interlobar fissures of the lungs and thymus. In the brain, petechiae are present in the white matter. They are also associated subarachnoid hemorrhage may be there because of the acute venous engorgement. Profuse petechiae and ecchymosis are also seen under the scalp for the same reason. Time taken for all the internal changes to occur varies from few seconds to several minutes depending upon the circumstances. Petechiae and ecchymosis are common non-specific findings and may also be seen in non-asphyxial deaths as well, as is seen in beneath the pericardium, pleura, interlobar fissures and around hilum. Most of the times, petechiae occur along with cyanosis and is very difficult to appreciate until unless the blood is drained out during the autopsy. Microscopic examination confirms the nature of the hemorrhage. The cutaneous and visceral petechiae can also appear and enlarge as a postmortem phenomena and can appear on front or back of corpse died of reasons other than asphyxia. Thus, petechiae are very unreliable indicator of asphyxial deaths. The natural diseases which produce hemorrhage in the skin are bacterial endocarditis, the blood dyscrasias, especially purpura and hemophilia, the meningococcal septicemia, coronary thrombosis, acute heart failure, and acute secondary shock. They are also seen in raised intrathoracic pressure like asthmatic attack, respiratory failure, heart failure, and soon after the delivery of a child. They are distributed generally, while tardive spots are present above the level of the obstruction. When the asphyxial signs are prolonged and slight, the congestive element will be diminished, but with intense and short duration, lividity and congestion are marked. Sometimes the findings may not be sufficient to use exact terminology of asphyxia, and a broader framework like consistent with asphyxia is being used. When we do the histology, under microscopic examination, the non-specific findings are seen like disruption of alveolar septa with hemorrhage in the alveoli and edema, brick red discoloration of nerve cells in the cortex, paler and vacuolar degeneration of Purkinje cells in the cerebellum, the vacuolar degeneration of liver cells, and chemical markers like hypoxanthine in blood and vitreous. Coming on to the delayed deaths, which is a rare phenomena, but when it occurs, it poses a great deal of difficulty. The delayed deaths in asphyxia are due to the fact that in asphyxia, the higher cortical centers first suffer from hypoxic injury and then followed by the basal ganglia and ultimately the vegetative centers. And these delayed deaths usually follow period of unconsciousness resulting from anoxic cerebral damage and hypostatic pneumonia. The other life-threatening sequelae are massive subcutaneous and mediastinal emphysema due to laryngeal and tracheal lacerations or occlusion of airway due to edematous or hemorrhagic swelling of pharyngeal tissues or the eriepiglottic fold. In such delayed deaths, the proximate cause of death is the principal traumatic incident. To summarize this introductory topic on the asphyxial deaths, it can be said that asphyxia is a condition caused by interference with respiration or due to lack of oxygen in respired air, due to which the organs and tissues are deprived of oxygen, together with failure to eliminate carbon dioxide, causing unconsciousness or ultimately death. The hypoxia occurs when the partial pressure of oxygen is less than 60 millimeters of mercury, even though the hemoglobin is 90% saturated. The severe hypoxia occurs when the PO2 is 40 millimeters of mercury, and death occurs when the PO2 is less than 20 millimeters of mercury. The petechial hemorrhage is mainly due to raised venous pressure leading to impaired venous return. In cases where the mode of death is congestive heart failure, they are also present in the normal postmortem hypostasis. Petechial hemorrhages are known as tardive spots, where there are more marked where capillary congestion is most prominent for mechanical reasons. If heart stops before respiration, the asphyxial signs will be less. The blood is dark in color and fluid because of the increased amount of carbon dioxide. The natural diseases which produce hemorrhage in the skin are bacterial endocarditis, blood dyscrasias, especially purpura and hemophilia, meningococcal septicemia, coronary thrombosis, acute heart failure, and acute secondary shock. Delayed deaths in asphyxia are due to fact that in asphyxia, the higher cortical centers suffer first from hypoxic injury, followed by injury to basal ganglia, and ultimately vegetative centers.